So today let's fix this Soviet digital alarm clock and let's see what's inside of it and how does it work. And of course I already have several of these in my collection, but I decided to fix another so you can see it. This one is one of the most common Soviet digital alarm clocks of the 80s. It's called Electronica 6. It has this main plug. It used to be a circle here, but somebody cut the sides of it so it can fit into a Czech socket with a grounded pin. Because back then, the Soviet socket didn't have any grounded pin. And the clock has a display behind plexiglass, this alarm on-off button. And on the back of it, let's turn it around and you can see this main cable going in here. 220 volts, 50 hertz. There is a fuse holder, 0.25 amps. And those buttons. This one is the alarm. When it's pressed, you can see the alarm setting and set it. And when it's out, you can see the time and set it. And this one sets the minutes and this one the hours of the timer alarm. And this one is the reset button. It resets the minutes. And very often you have to press this button initially after you plug it in to manually reset the chips and make it work properly. And let's take a closer look here. The type is Electronica 6.15. Some series number on it, the date of production 0982, so it's made in 1982, and the price of it was 45 rubles. How much you can buy for 45 rubles nowadays? And here is the backup battery cover. It uses a 9 volt battery for backup, and this battery is just for the backup, not for the display. When it runs on a battery, it keeps the time, but the display is off. Let's take the battery out. I hope it's not leaking, because old batteries very often leak and when not using something, you should remove them. And here's the battery, Varta Super, 0% mercury and cadmium. And the expiration date is 97, so it was probably made in early or mid 90s. And the voltage on it is 0.2 volts, of course. I think no battery can last that long, but luckily it's not leaking. And here's the battery clip going into the box. Now let's explore the fuse. It's in a fuse holder. You press it, rotate it counterclockwise, and the fuse comes out. It's in this holder and it has a date code on it. It's made in 82, just like the clock. 0.25 amps. Let's put it back. You can actually see that there is a seal still on this screw and on this screw as well. So this one was never opened. So let's try to test it and the battery is not needed for this. And now of course let's plug it in. And it seems to be dead. Nothing on the display. Now the alarm comes on and besides the alarm, I can also hear some buzzing. It seems like mains ripple is also coming from the alarm speaker. And there is a vacuum fluorescent display in these clocks. It can be worn out or very often it stops working when the clock is dropped or maybe the display is just not getting some of its voltages. And of course the buzzing coming from the alarm speaker suggests some dried out electrolytic capacitors. So there is a mains ripple going into it. But of course the buzzing can also be caused by the display multiplex frequency, which is 128 Hz in this clock. The ripple coming from the multiplex could also get into the speaker if the capacitors are bad. Well, I tried to power it in the dark and I can actually see very dimly something on the display. It seems that either the display is not getting the right voltage for it or it's extremely worn out. This would be the deadest display I have ever seen when restoring these clocks. And this is dimmer than it looks in the camera. It seems like the clock actually works, but the display is extremely worn out. And of course a comparison with a good one. Now it just completely overloads the camera at this sensitivity level and when I dim it, you don't even see the bad one. And the other one is a slightly newer version of it, made in 87 according to this label, and it has one extra button. And this switches the brightness of the display in two levels, brighter or dimmer. But strangely it doesn't dim the dot is still bright. and it has one extra oddity. You can only set it when the brightness setting is set to the higher brightness. When you switch it to the lower brightness, the buttons to set it don't work. But now let's finally open the bed one, using four screws, and unfortunately I have to break the seals. And now the back comes off. Here's the cable going to the battery clip. And here's the fuse holder, the cable from the plug going in. And the board. Here you can see the iron transformer, the alarm speaker with a date code, the control buttons, this alarm on-off switch. And here's the display. Some electrolytic capacitor, another electrolytic capacitor here. And of course I have a lot of these, which look almost identical from the outside, but in each of them the internals are slightly different. There was a lot of modifications during the production. And the board basically slides out, it's in slots, but before sliding it out you have to press this in and then remove this plastic bit from it and take it away so you don't break the support of this switch. And then it can be pulled out. And that's it. Here is just the box with the green plexiglass in front of it. And the screws go into these plastic bits in the corners, but they have metal bits in them. Probably brass. It seems to be brazen. So the screw actually screws into metal, not plastic. These Soviet clocks are designed very nicely and very crudely at the same time. Here's the main transformer, which is very crudely tied to the board using those iron wires, probably. And it really looks quite crude, but this is actually much better than if the transformer hangs on the board just by the pins. Because then the pins get easily pulled out of it and it's destroyed. So here's the main transformer with a welded core and the windings. Here's the primary and here's the secondaries. And there is actually a separate space for the primary and a separate space for the secondaries. So it actually looks kind of safe even up to modern standards. And there is a thick plastic insulation between the windings. Here you can see the buttons, which are really big proper buttons. No tiny micro switches. Here's the bridge rectifier made of discrete diodes. A lot of resistors here. Some diodes here, probably zeners. The five chips. Some ceramic capacitors, some transistors. The crystal with a date code 81. And these chips have a date code 82. And these have a date code 80. Even the transistors have a date code 82. Virtually every component in those Soviet devices have a date code. Here is an electrolytic capacitor 50 volts, 100 microfarads, 82. And the other one, 16 volts, 200 microfarads, 82. And the ceramic capacitors, 68 nanofarads, 82 again. And of course here is the vacuum fluorescent display with 4 7-segment digits and 2 dots. It has basically these 3 heaters running across it and each digit has a grid to multiplex it and the segments are the anodes. And the dots have a separate grid for them. And this is driven in multiplex, so for example this segment is connected with this one and this one. This segment is connected with this one and this one, and it lights up the digits one after another, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. It enables them by bringing a positive voltage on the grid, and then it also brings a positive voltage on the segments that are meant to be lit in this digit. And then it goes to the next digit, activates it by using a positive voltage on the grid end, and also a positive voltage on the segments that are meant to be lit, and it goes through all four and then it repeats. And here is the evacuation stem of the display, because it has a vacuum in it, and the pins of the display. The marking IVL175 made in 82, and you can see the connections going between the segments. Here you can see it, for example this segment goes like this to the same segment of the other digit and basically all the segments on the same position. It's in a multiplex, it doesn't even have enough pins for each segment in it. It has a crystal here with some capacitors in a crystal oscillator and an unusual 20 mega ohm resistor here. and this speaker probably has some transistor oscillator for it to make it beep to generate couple kilohertz for it. And a lot of resistors for the segments and grids of the display. And the transformer has two secondaries, one for the heater of the display and the other one for the anode voltage, rectified by these diodes and regulated by these zeners. And now, of course, let's explain the schematic of it. Basically, the mains comes in here through the fuse, here's the transformer, here's the heater winding, which goes into the heater of the display here, and it's directly heated, so the center tap of this heater winding is used as the cathode connection, and the anode winding goes into a bridge rectifier, and then into this smoothing capacitor, and I guess there is meant to be a dot, it's meant to be a connection, not a crossing, and this supplies several voltages with a common positive. The highest voltage it supplies actually is taken straight from the capacitor and it goes to those pull-down resistors for the segments and grids. And then it's dropped by a resistor to a bit lower voltage, and this is used by the common negative for these chips and basically to drive the display electrodes. And of course the grids and the anodes of the segments, when inactive, have to be driven a bit negative in reference to the cathode. So the pull-down resistors are actually connected to a voltage a bit more negative than the voltage for the chip here. And I guess the zeners are about 9 volts, so 3 in series are about 27 volts to drive the electrodes of the display, and one of them is 9 volts. And this powers the logic chips here. And these chips are just drivers or buffers or inverters, or they basically interface the lower voltage of the logic with the higher voltage for the display. And the grids are enabling individual digits of the display for the multiplex, 4 grids for the digits and 1 for the dots, which is connected to a random other digit grid, so it actually runs at the same duty cycle and has the same brightness. And here are the anodes. 7 anodes for the segments and 2 for the dots. The dots are connected with each other here and they are blinking. And the segments are connected via buffers to this 7-segment decoder. And this basically goes from a binary to 7 segments. This chip has binary inputs 1, 2, 4, 8 and 7-segment outputs. This just inverts it or brings it to a higher voltage level. And this one is the same chip as this one. It interfaces the multiplexing grids with this chip. So the first chip basically is a crystal oscillator with this crystal, some capacitors and a tuning capacitor for adjustment of the speed. And it works as a frequency divider. It has various outputs with various frequencies. And from this crystal oscillator and frequency divider chip, it goes into this main chip, which basically counts the time, it remembers the alarm setting, and when the time matches with the alarm setting, it actually enables the alarm. It's probably self-oscillating with this speaker with a third electrode for feedback, and it's somehow enabled through these transistors, even though this doesn't make much sense to me, actually. And of course, the accuracy of these schematics is a bit questionable. And this main clock chip has binary outputs, which have to be decoded to 7 segments for the display. And it also uses a 9-volt battery backup, and the battery seems to go to this double line. It's probably the connector, but anyway, here it goes into a short circuit. Are you kidding me, guys? I think the positive was actually meant to be connected to the positive of these capacitors. And I would also expect some diode preventing the battery from being charged, because it's not a rechargeable battery. And this is probably the alarm enable button, this is the reset button, and this switch displays the alarm setting, and this sets the minutes and hours. And these three switches are actually sensed in a multiplex. They are connected to the multiplex lines of the display grids and sensed by just one wire and one input of this clock main chip. And what are the most common failures? Well, the display wears out slowly over time, but it can probably last for many years of continuous operation. Very often the display is damaged by dropping the clock. And of course the electrolytic capacitors dry out and go open circuit or high ESR and low capacitance. This one has 2 capacitors, but some versions have just 1. The one after the bridge rectifier is necessary and the other one kind of isn't necessary because now the voltage is already smooth and regulated by the zener, so the ceramic one might be actually enough. Some versions have just the ceramic one, and sometimes when this one dries out, it still works. And sometimes the crystal actually fails. And it's a standard frequency, low frequency crystal, 32768 Hz. And it can actually be replaced using a modern crystal. And of course the buttons can have a poor contact, they can oxidize, you can use a contact cleaner, but it doesn't actually happen very often. Also transistors might fail in it, but this is more common for the non-multiplexed versions, which have completely different display and different chips. And of course the transformer might short internally, but it's rare. Sometimes the display can have internal shorts between the segments, then two different segments always light up simultaneously on all digits. And of course these buffers could go wrong and then one segment is always on or always off, probably. But of course this is the old version with the buffers. Most of the versions don't have them. They basically have just three chips instead of five, and the display is driven straight from the chip here. The grids are also driven, without these buffers, straight from this chip. And this chip, K176ID2, has normal logic outputs, which are pulled either positive or negative, but the newer versions without the buffer use ID3, which only pulls the outputs positive, and when they're inactive, they're floating. And then the outputs are basically open drains of p-channel MOSFETs. And of course, again, if one of the output transistors is damaged, the output is always on or always off, and one segment on each digit is always on or always off. And here the oscillator chip is K176IE12. It's the older version, which doesn't have the brightness setting. The newer version of it, K176IE18, has an input for a brightness switch, and then it can switch two levels of brightness by switching a duty cycle of each grid. It basically multiplexes the display with a certain dead time, and for the lower brightness, the dead time is longer. And this oscillator chip doesn't really fail very often, but if it fails, I think either the oscillator completely stops and then only one digit stays lit, because the multiplex stops, or some of the frequency outputs stops and the clock stops, or maybe one of the multiplex outputs can go open a circuit so one digit disappears, or one output shorts and then one digit is very bright and it basically shows all digits one over another. And of course the clock and the multiplex can be randomly intermittently stopping and starting. This could also be this chip, but it also might be the crystal. And this crystal oscillator chip and this 7-segment decoder chips are a bit different in the newer versions, but this chip remains the same in all versions. And of course I'm not talking about the non-multiplexed version and the single chip versions, but about these 3 or 5 chip versions. And this is the main control chip of it, the main brain of it. This keeps the time, remembers the alarm and so on. And if this one fails, it very often goes completely crazy. And there are random numbers jumping on the display and it's randomly changing the time and it's randomly flickering. When this main control chip fails, the entire thing goes completely crazy. And then it of course needs this main chip replaced. And of course a certain country also needs its main control chip replaced. And an example of a newer version, much more simple and just three chips, K176IE18 crystal oscillator, multiplexing the display straight without the buffers, and also controlling the segments without the buffers using this K176ID3 7-segment decoder, and the main control chip K176IE13 remains. Here it has the brightness selector, this changes the pulse width for the grids, the alarm enable switch, and here the buzzer doesn't have a transistor oscillator for it. Here it gets an audible frequency straight from the output of this chip, probably 1024Hz or 2048. It's basically a binary division from the frequency of the crystal. So the frequency for the buzzer goes straight from the chip, instead of using a discrete transistor oscillator, which is just enabled using a DC voltage from this chip. And again the minute setting, hour setting and alarm setting buttons, and the reset button. And the power supply has just a single diode rectifier, and again the smoothing capacitor. And the most negative voltage goes to the pull-down resistors, then a bit less negative voltage goes to the cathode, and then it's further dropped to about 9 volts for the chips. And here the backup 9-volt battery has a diode to prevent charging it. This makes more sense. And of course the clock functionality is kind of strangely divided between three chips. It's like designing a clock control chip and then completely randomly cutting it into three pieces. And of course a simple diagram of how this crystal oscillator and frequency divider chip works. It has two crystal oscillator pins, a separate section in it, driving the speaker. This enable input gets a signal from the main chip to enable the alarm, and this produces a certain frequency for the speaker. Here's the brightness selection input, and the reset input, and it has multiple outputs with different frequencies. A 1/60th of a hertz output, this goes into the main chip, advancing the minutes. A 1 hertz output, this blinks the dots. A 2 hertz output goes into the main chip again, and a 1024 hertz output, clocking the main control chip. And these four 128 hertz outputs, and they are basically switching 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and this goes into the display, multiplexing it. And of course two extra pins for 9 volts and 0 volts. And this supplies several frequencies into the main control chip, and it kind of raises a question, why doesn't the main control chip actually divide the frequencies itself? It has to be interconnected with the divider chip using several lines, 3 here and another 2 here. It's really a clock control chip randomly cut in half or into 3 pieces. And of course these two chips have to be somehow synchronized, because this one controls the segments through the 7-segment decoder, and this one controls the grids multiplexing the digits. And it either somehow manages to synchronize on a power-up, or you have to synchronize it manually by pressing the reset button. Otherwise the digits on the display are shifted. But the circuitry is actually surprisingly simple. And I was thinking, is it possible to modify it for NXEs instead of a vacuum fluorescent display? And it's actually possible. You can just leave this chip and replace this binary to 7-segment decoder using a binary to 1 out of 10 decoder. Of course the one suitable for NXEs with 10 open collector high voltage outputs. But then I bumped into another problem, another oddity of these chips. I was thinking that the binary outputs of this chip go just the first digit, second digit, third digit, fourth digit and back. But they actually go first digit 0, second digit 0, third digit 0, fourth digit 0. It's kind of inserting 0 between the digits for absolutely no good reason, or I'm not getting it. And this is solved by having latches in this 7-segment decoder, which make it not transparent for the zeros. Besides the four binary inputs, it has this update input, and it's only transparent when this input gets a signal. But why does it have to actually put zeros at the outputs, and why the latches that hide the zeros are not a part of this chip? Were they limited by a certain number of transistors in a chip, and then the complexity just overflows into another chip, or I don't know. So I solved it by putting latches in between of the chips. This chip, K561TM3, has 6 latches in it, I'm using 4. And this is inserted between the main control chip and the NXE driver chip, which goes from binary to 1 out of 10. And of course the anodes have to be multiplexed using a higher voltage, so each multiplex output gets an NPN transistor and a PNP transistor to switch the higher positive voltage. And it uses these Soviet NXEs, IN82, made in 73. I've built this prototype about 2 or 3 years ago, and I still have to put it on a board and give it some power supply. But I'm diverging a lot. Let's actually fix this clock, the older version, and then I can also take a short peek into this newer version, this one. The display is probably worn out, but also the electrolytic capacitors can be bad. I should probably check the capacitors and replace them if they are bad, and then I can see if the display gets better, and if it's still very dim, I can replace the display. And you can see the segments are kind of darkened, grey. A new vacuum fluorescent display has snow-white segments, but as it wears out, it gets darker, it's getting grey and of course dimmer. The phosphor wears out, but also the emissive layer on the cathodes wears out. And of course vacuum fluorescent displays can't really be regenerated or restored or rejuvenated or whatever you call it. Or maybe very briefly by raising the heater voltage or by briefly applying a higher voltage on the heater, but it never lasts, just like in CRTs. It's quite different from NXEs, which can be rejuvenated and then work for many, many more years. And I, for example, specifically chose the most worn out NXEs for this clock and I regenerated them, and now they work for about 6 years continuously and still fine. This is my NXE clock made of a vintage Czechoslovak Tesla components, with these chips and these NXEs. And of course I keep diverging and this video is going to get bloody long. But now of course let's measure the ESR of these capacitors. This one is 200 micro 16 volts. This is on the 9 volt rail. And it's kind of acceptable, definitely on the higher side, but it should probably still run, especially given that this capacitor is not really necessary anyway. And the other one, 100 micro 50 volts, and this one is just completely open circuit, completely dried out. And this one is straight after the bridge rectifier. So let's desolder it very carefully and of course, the traces on the borders of these Soviet clocks very easily come off. And the capacitor's out, 50 volts, 100 microfarads, with this plastic support and the pins of it. One more test, completely open circuit, or at least 100 ohms, the meter doesn't go any higher. Measuring the capacitance, barely half a microfarad. Certain components deteriorate over time, and some even when not in use. Threaten the entire world with machinery full of such components, sitting with no maintenance for decades. Let's try to put some other capacitor in it. The same or higher voltage rating and the same capacitance. And it's just a power supply, so if the capacitance is a bit higher, it doesn't matter. Random capacitor from random CRT monitor. 140 milliohms ESR and 105 microfarads. Seems nice. And of course keep the same polarity. Electrolytic capacitors are polarized and here the polarity marking seems to be around the pins. Weird. The new capacitor's in, it's soldered. Now let's try to test it to see if it makes the display brighter, but I don't have much hope for it. And of course you can probably get some extra brightness just by cleaning the internals of it. The inner side of the plexiglass. Nice. Just take a look at it. And there is the tuning capacitor to adjust the speed and there is a hole for it in the box. You can adjust it without opening the entire clock. Just remove this cover on the bottom and it's already missing in the other one. And let's test it again. It very slowly comes on and it's still quite dim. And the very slow warm-up probably indicates a worn-out cathode. Or it could be a lower heater voltage, but I doubt it. And the heater voltage is meant to be 5 volts, the first and the last pin. And it's actually 5.75. It's about 15% more than it should be. This of course speeds up the wear, but it also makes a worn out display look a bit better than it actually is. But of course the clock was meant for 220 volt mains, and the actual voltage now is 230. But this doesn't completely explain the higher voltage. The mains is about 5% up, but the heater voltage is about 15% up. Is the transformer poorly designed? Or maybe the heater voltage is higher because the other secondary is not loaded much, because the worn-out display doesn't draw much current. And the DC voltage on the replaced capacitor right after the bridge rectifier is 43 volts. And this is regulated down using the three zeners in series to about 26.5 volts, close to 27, 3 times 9. And the chips are powered just from the upper zener, 9.8 volts. This one is 8.2 and this one is 8.3. And from this upper zener, 9.8 volts, it goes into this electrolytic capacitor via a diode, which drops about half a volt. And then the chips get about 9.3 volts. Here are the zeners. The upper one regulates the voltage for the chips and this diode drops something and then it goes into these capacitors and into the chips. All the voltages are right. This thing basically needs a new display. But let's give it one more chance. Let's do an experiment. Let's try to connect a higher voltage on the heater for a couple seconds to try to rejuvenate it. Of course this doesn't help the darkened phosphor, but it still can get much better if the emission of the cathode is higher. I have actually seen a similar clock with much darker phosphor, yet still brighter than this one. So the cathode can be the main reason why it's so dim. Let's disconnect one of the heater terminals. We connected it to a bench power supply and let's slowly bring the voltage up to about 10 volts for several seconds. 10 volts for about 10 seconds. You reconnected the heater to the original winding and it's maybe a bit better, but still only visible in low light. Let's try to slowly bring it to 15 volts for a couple seconds. 15. And let's go back. Now I have to say it actually improved noticeably, but still really not for a bright room. It's dimmer than the good one, even at the lower brightness. Let's try 20 volts for a couple seconds, slowly going up. And let's go back. Well, it actually got brighter than the new display at its lower setting. It looked completely amazing. It ran like this for about 20 seconds. But unfortunately, before I started the camera, it started flickering and getting dimmer and dimmer, and then it completely died. Well, there is maybe something super dim on it still, but it's worse than before. Now it's actually getting better by itself. And now it's getting dimmer again. Now it died completely. Well, now it's again as bright as the new one at its lower setting. And the brightness also changes a bit when I shake it. Well, nice. Now it works again, but the brightness of it fluctuates. I guess the heater has an intermittent connection inside of it. Maybe I used a too high regeneration voltage. 20 volts is 4 times the nominal. Or maybe the connection to the heater was bad, even before the regeneration. I gave the heater several pulses of 16 volts, now connecting it suddenly instead of bringing the voltage up slowly. And of course this is not recommended, but maybe this welded the poor internal connection of the heater back. Now it looks kind of stable and it runs. And the brightness is about like this one on the lower setting. This one has no brightness control, so it's always at the high setting. I will probably have to give it a new display anyway, but out of curiosity, I will leave it running for some time to see what happens. But let's take a look at some datasheets of the displays. Here's the connection to the pins. And the other side might say some voltages and currents. And the heater current is 108 to 132 milliamps, nominal 120. The current of all segments of one digit at most 12 milliamps. One grid at most 12 milliamps. And the heater voltage is from 4.5 to 5.8 volts. And the peak voltage of the segments and grids can be 50 volts at most. And one segment 2 milliamps. And it seems to recommend 27 volts for the display, grids and anodes, or segments. And something about the duty cycle. And it's interesting to note the exponent in this formula, 5 over 2, which is 2.5. The brightness of a vacuum fluorescent display goes up with the 2.5th power of the voltage. And something here. The segments are starting to light up at about 2.5 to 3 volts. So to ensure they are off, the voltage has to be no more than about 1.5 to 2 volts. And the grids, to turn the digit completely off, have to have at least minus 7 volts on them. One more datasheet which says virtually the same. And this one says the nominals, 5 volts heater, and it's of course AC. And grids and segments, 27 volts DC. And the duty cycle, and Russians actually use the opposite of a duty cycle, its inverted value, so 5 minus 20%, 1 divided by 5 or 0.2. And of course the display has 4 digits, not 5, but there is some dead time. And there actually seem to be 2 versions of the display, this one from the early 80s and this one from the late 80s. And the earlier version seems to be less reliable. It seems to have this strange glass bar on it and this keeps the pins in place and very often they lose connection. In the newer version the pins goes straight inside and this one doesn't tend to lose connection. And of course the one I was repairing had this older display and the heater in it seems to be prone to losing connection somewhere. The less reliable one is from 83, the better one is from 87. And on top of it there is another type of the display, which is almost identical, but it has a different type number. And the only difference is that there is a bell symbol on it instead of the dot here. It's a bit later, it has a different type number and it says made in USSR in Russian. And this type was probably produced even after the collapse of Soviet Union. And this later piece is from 1995. It actually says made in Ukraine on it. And one more. This one is from 1999, it's quite late. And the datasheet of the one with the bell symbol, it all seems the same. And this thing is getting very dim again, so let's tow it away using a tractor and let's give it a Ukrainian display. Or maybe not, because this one has 2 blinking dots. The display with 2 dots is actually more suitable for it. This one is different because it has just 1 blinking dot and The upper one actually indicates when the alarm is enabled. This one has dots, but the bell would actually make sense in this one. This one has to get a double dot. You can actually parallel it for a quick test, and it seems to work. Just put it on the pins and that's it. The one with the bell would constantly blink the bell. And let's actually show one example of a bad display. The upper dot is shorted with the grid of this digit. When I lift the pin of the dot, the upper one, it seems to work. But anyway, this is probably going to be my longest video, so let's just quickly give it a good display and that's it. In this version of the clock, the display is tricky to desolder and we care about the board, not the display, so it's actually better to cut the pins and then desolder them individually. So let's cut it. And the display just slides out, hopefully. Pulling the pins out. And of course a trace came off going to this hole. Trying to clean the holes. It's also possible to heat it and poke the solder out of the hole. You can also solder the new display to the pins of the old one. It of course looks horrible, but at least the board is not going to fall apart in the process. So the holes are cleaned and of course my horrible soldering techniques, but just look at the original soldering. This really can't get any worse. But anyway, it worked for 40 years. Maybe this can last much longer than a modern nice soldering. And just one track coming off is actually a good result. And here's it without the display. This is not what you normally see. The broken track will be replaced using a wire. The display slided in, let's solder it. So the display is soldered in. And let's test it. And it works nicely. But the heater voltage is still a bit too high. As usual, I will put a resistor in series, probably here. And it's quite bright. This is under very bright lights. Let's take a peek into the other one. The seals are already broken anyway. And that's it. It's quite similar actually. It's similar, but it has just three chips. One extra button. The transformer is mounted a bit better. Two electrolytic capacitors, original ones. The speaker is from 86. Again some zeners. And the display. And this one has actually some components from the other side. The bridge rectifier and this third zener. And this one is actually much more friendly when replacing the display. The display pins actually go through these big holes and then they are soldered here. So basically when replacing the display, you can just desolder and lift up individual pins of the display one after another and you don't have to clean solder from holes and this is just way easier to replace. And also the soldering quality looks a tiny bit better maybe. And of course here's the resistor I added in series with the heater when I replaced the display. And the display holders are on screws, not just a molten and mashed piece of plastic sticking through the hole like in the other one. And to adjust the heater voltage, usually a 2.2, 3.3 or 4.7 ohm resistor is fine. But of course this is based on the voltage you measure on the display heater. You're aiming at 5 volts. Or maybe they were aiming at the middle of the interval, which would be 5.15. Now let's try to stick an oscilloscope into it and for this let's run it through an isolation transformer. And yes, this track is on the secondary side and this one is on the primary side. And of course for a Soviet clock, a Soviet oscilloscope. And this is the signal on two grids of the display. This one gets a pulse and then this one gets a pulse. And this is at a higher brightness. And this is the lower brightness. And you can see that it changes the brightness by changing the duty cycle on the grids. But even at the higher brightness, there is still some dead time between them. Now the upper trace is the 1024Hz clock signal. And the lower one is one grid. At the full brightness, the dead time is probably one cycle of the clock signal and the digit is on for 7 cycles. And at the lower brightness, I think, the dead time is 6 cycles and the digit is on for 2 cycles. So the duty cycle of one digit is 7 out of 32 at high brightness and 2 out of 32 at low brightness. And I gave it a resistrain series with the heater, and now the voltage is about right. Here's the horribly botched resistor. I was aiming at about 5 or 5.1 volts, when the mains voltage is at its nominal or typical value, because of course the heater voltage changes proportionally with the mains voltage. And of course too high heater voltage wears the cathode faster, but even too low voltage wears it faster. And maybe finally, rejuvenating vacuum fluorescent displays might be possible, but in this case there was some other problem other than just the wear of the cathode. I think the connections to the heater were intermittent or high resistance. So that's the old 5-chip version, that's the simplest form of the 3-chip version. And there is actually a couple more versions of it, this one and this one for example. This time I didn't even have to replace any chips. Here is some datasheet of the chips. And there is also a non-multiplexed Soviet clock which uses 4 such displays. But I've already shown it in a video a couple years ago. And it's weird that the fuse is 250 milliamps and the clocks actually draw 18 milliamps. And this one about 17 milliamps. Maybe a lower current fuse would make it a bit safer. And the power consumption tends to be about 2 watts. So that's it, and this is probably my longest video, and if you made it that far, please consider supporting my channel on Patreon. Because I really like going in depth and really learning you something, instead of making short stupid videos for dumb masses. I don't want to be a channel which just hooks something to a battery and a switch, or smashes something or blows up capacitors for entertainment, or keeps shorting mains voltage for fun or something like this. I don't like choosing topics based on what makes the most views. And of course the longer the video is, the harder it is to make, but the less views it usually makes. But your support on Patreon helps me not to focus on the view count. So big thanks for your support, and I also plan to take a look at some interesting devices like this power factor meter or this watt meter. And I will also take a look inside of some better chargers donated by a viewer.